We have breached into professional incest.
That's just a fun thing.
No.
Okay, well...
Well, Lauren has already also lost her phone, and Elijah is leaving, something I usually do.
I don't... Wait, hold on. We might have to restart.
Yeah, we might have to restart.
Oh, thank God.
Everybody, come on, it's time to listen. Get together, the show's about to begin. Bring your friends and your cows and all your chickens.
Here we go again.
Time to laugh and maybe even learn something. Oh, who am I kidding? You're not gonna laugh. Either way, it's time to get started with
The Sundial Podcast.
Hello, and welcome to the fourth episode of the Sundial Podcast.
2.0. No, it's a great bit. It's a great, it's a little bit of a joke.
I am your host, Lauren Moliterno, Editor-in-Chief of the Sundial.
And I am second most important, James Wagner, webmaster of the Sundial Humor Magazine. Now, apparently, the last few weeks I have been kind of confusing that I didn't put enough separation in my title, and so it sounded like I was the second most important webmaster, which is a false claim. I am the most important webmaster, second most important member of the Sundial, behind Lauren Moliterno, which, that's up to debate.
Okay, let's debate it.
All right, let's go. Point one, I'm the webmaster.
All right, no, you win.
Yep, I win. Okay, so this is now my podcast. All right, I want to turn it... my goal, which I've stated before, is that I'm going to slowly try to turn this into a morning radio show. So next week, or whenever you listen to this, it is only available at 5 in the morning on your drive to work.
That's it.
That's going to be the only time this is available. We're going to start adding wacky sound effects. We've already tried.
We already tried.
But we're going to add one. Let's see if it works. Hey, editor.
No.
All right, I'm not doing it. All right, let's, should we introduce our guests?
Yeah, we should.
Up first, we have the person to my right, Mr. Archie Barton.
Hey, that's me, and this is my voice.
That's his voice. Learn it well, because you will probably hear it.
It's very sensual, I've been told.
Mm-hmm. Yep. It's Central Ohio, right?
Very Central Ohio, yeah.
Central Ohio. All right, and then to his right, the literal definition of sensual, Mr. Elijah Saiger.
A little bit louder.
A little bit lighter.
Hello.
Yeah, we're not just deaf dogs are listening to this. You need to actually speak up. Ooh, yeah, that was a really...
Burn.
Don't think about that. Don't think about that insult. It makes no sense.
No.
But yeah, so this is a highly, highly requested episode of the combination of you two.
Yeah, we were asked a lot.
Yeah, I hope that... I know I have a lot of fans out there.
Mm-hmm. Shout out to those lie sheds.
And a lot of the time when I come on these programs, they just flood the inbox of whoever's running it. And a lot of the time their computers crash, which is pretty exciting for me. But, you know... It's pretty hard for them. So I hope that you guys didn't get too much.
No. We got a lot.
We got
a lot of comments on YouTube, which is weird because we've never posted about the podcast on YouTube.
No, we have not.
No.
But I did.
Elijah, famous for his vlogs.
Yes.
Elijah's a big vlogger on YouTube.
I actually have a cooking show.
Ooh, a cooking show. Sorry, I mistake cooking for showing of daily life. I'm sorry. He does have a cooking show. Elijah, you want to... I know we'll get to plugs at the end, but do you want to plug that show right now?
No, it has enough popularity.
All right, we'll wait till the end. All right. RG, you have any cooking shows you want to plug?
My cooking show.
Ooh.
Whoa, is it rivaling?
It's a rival cooking show. It takes place in the same kitchen. But I don't use any pots or pans.
Ooh, so do you just use your hands as utensils, or do you just use bowls, and you just use a bunch of the bowls?
Yes.
So both hands and bowls.
My hands are bowls.
Your hands are bowls. This isn't a visual podcast. Once again, we apologize for that. But RG's hands, if you haven't noticed, are actually just bowls.
They're bowls.
Very easy to eat cereal for you.
Yeah, not to get the cereal in there. That's a little bit more difficult.
I think my
hands are bigger than RG's, so in a way I've already won.
Hold on.
The cooking show challenge?
They're about the same.
They're about the same size. I'm also here to plug my cooking show. We just go, it's called Good Eats. It's on Food Network. It ran from 2004 to about 2011. And this is where I rip off my mask and I reveal that I'm Alton Brown.
Alton the whole time.
I've been Alton the whole time. And I would have gotten away with it had I not been on this podcast and reviewed my true identity.
Also, the Scooby-Doo bunches right over there.
Yeah, oh, I didn't see them.
Oh, they would have got you.
They are going to say some stuff, but we're going to have to mute them for legal purposes.
That's true.
Because we do not have the rights to Hanna-Barbera material. So, here we go. They're going to start, and then we'll pick up when they stop. All right, we're back. They had this real big monologue. It was great. Lauren, you want to plug your cooking show?
Yeah. And. Just kidding. It's just me making plain noodles with nothing on them every week. Nice.
So no water, just
noodles. I make the noodles. I just don't put anything on them.
There's nothing else on them.
I just eat plain noodles.
And then it's a 10-minute shot of you sadly eating noodles.
Yeah, it's like real time. Like you watch me put the water on the boil, and then you wait for it to boil.
That's the best part.
There is actually a there's a YouTube series that is called While the Pasta Boils with Hannah Hart. Shout out to somebody I don't know. And then there's also Bobby Flay was on a Food Network show that was basically about that, and the flaw from it was in his pilot episode. He couldn't figure out how to turn the oven on, and it's like him quoted, "I can't figure out how to boil this water."
Can we talk about Bobby Flay? Yeah, I'd love to talk about
Bobby. Let's talk about Bobby Flay, guys.
Okay, he's the worst person in the world, right?
Interesting.
Because
I don't have a strong opinion of Bobby Flay. Inform me.
I kind of do. Me and my brother way more than me. My brother is very passionate about hating Bobby Flay. Mm-hmm. I am like a average hater of Bobby Flay. Mm-hmm. But it's just
Bobby
crazy.
Bobby Flater.
I'm a Bobby Flater. So like what he does, well, he had that show where he just would go to like people's restaurants and be like, "I bet you can't beat me at the thing that you're known for." How is that not the biggest dick move in the history of dick moves?
It's just pretty dickish, but like if they can't, then
but here's the thing.
That's what and then it's like what Bobby Flay just gets these kicks out of beating people at what they're good at.
Some type of narcissist.
Right?
Thing,
and then like his other show that he has other chefs compete at the chance to try and beat him, and it's just like you're the worst.
I would like that he's actually just a really bad chef, but since his mom is Paula Deen, that they everybody
that's
yeah.
not okay.
Yeah,
that's,
his mom is Paula Deen.
Sure,
I'm 100% sure. I am 100%. Resident Sundial podcast fact checker Archie Barton is going to check these facts. I'm, like, 100% sure.
Oh, no, he's just taking Snapchats.
Yeah.
No, that's just Snapchats.
That's just the face he makes.
You know, I really got to say, Bobby Flay is the EP of my YouTube channel.
Oh, no.
So you're a little conflicted.
He looks at the press that I've done, a lot of the podcast, because as I've said, I'm extremely popular.
Yeah.
And
we've gotten the comments
on YouTube.
He's probably
going to hear this, so I think you might want to...
I should...
You should scale it back or apologize, you know.
Wait, our official fact checker has some facts.
His mother's name is Dorothy Flay.
Oh, a nickname for Paula Deen.
I just want to know why you thought Paula Deen was his mom.
I have different names.
Well, you never know.
I would have been, even if her name was Paula Flay, I'd like that.
Also, she would not be famous if her name was Paula Flay.
That's very true. Yeah.
No, I guess I feel like she does have a son that did cooking.
Yeah, but not Bobby Flay. Bobby Flay is like,
I feel like
the Bobby Flay of cooking.
Bobby Flavor.
He's the Bobby. Guy Fieri didn't already take me, he would take me to Flavortown.
Yeah.
Yep.
Can we also talk about Guy Fieri?
Yeah, what's up with him?
What's up with that guy?
He's worse than...
He's worse than everyone.
He's worse than all of them.
Wait, but you said, and I quote... Bobby Flay is the worst.
So, I think I did say that.
You made a pretty strong comparative statement.
I did.
So, who's the worst, Lauren?
Well, they're worse in different ways.
Ah. Explain.
Like, Bobby Flay is the worst because, like, he's a narcissist. Like, that's kind of the worst. But, like, go ahead,
what's
Elijah.
The other one? Guy Fieri?
Guy Fieri. Guy Fieri's like, just, like,
he's
the
worst.
He's
the Beastie Boys of culinary arts.
I mean, he's the Smash Mouth.
Yeah.
Of culinary arts. I know people have made this comparison, and there's a picture of him with the lead singer of Smash Mouth on Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives.
Oh, that's funny.
Which is crazy that Guy Fieri won the first Food Network Star show, right?
Correct.
And then he got a show where he did, like, a traditional, like, OG Food Network show. like Paula Deen had, like all these other people had, like Barefoot
Contesta. I like how limited our examples are.
Barefoot Contesta.
Contesta?
Contesta. I know that's the perfect Italian. We don't have to get the Italian translator out again. And
there's no T in it.
No. I'm...
Contesta.
Much, I've been 100% correct this entire podcast. I think I'm right. Sure. And then there's also Unwrapped with Mark Summers.
Of course.
I think that's...
that's not a typical cooking show, though.
No, it
that's
is not. One, but it's still
a good show.
It's the How It's Made of the Food Network shows.
Yeah.
And it's also always, like... this like it's like this like weirdly pro
wait, what did you fact check?
It's very nostalgic.
Yes.
I'm just reading his wiki page.
RG, that's why RG isn't talking. Is he just reading Bobby Flay's wiki page?
No, this is Guy Fieri.
Oh, Guy Fieri, give us a nice factoid that you found.
His first food thing was a pretzel cart called Awesome Pretzel.
That's so creative. That's
how also
he was in
like
grade. He was in grade school, oh. But like
Bobby Flay.
No, this is Guy Fieri. I'm just imagining. Like,
wait, hold on. I love that we keep confusing Guy Fieri for Bobby Flay.
I'm gonna add in another name, though. This one won't be confused. Mark, I have a really funny Mark. Well, I don't have a really funny, but it's a very interesting based on personality how he got this show.
Mark Summers.
Mark Summers.
But Mark Summers isn't technically a cooking TV.
No, but he went on. There was this Food Network series that ran in like 2006, 2007. That was Best I Ever Had, and it was they would go through and say the best like barbecue they had ever had, the best just home style cooking they had ever had, and they had Mark Summers on, and it was like Americana food, like hamburgers, fries, all that sort of stuff. And they're like, "So Mark Summers, where's the best place you ever got to get a hamburger?" He's like, "Well, I love a good Steak and Shake burger."
You know, it's...
it's a good burger, but it's just like, what?
Why is that the best one you've ever had?
And it's so... it's like he didn't know what show he was on. He was just like, I love Steak and Shake. Founded in 1947.
You know Roger Ebert?
Yeah.
So he's, like, obsessed with Steak and Shake.
Is that what...
So,
they have, like, a bunch of, like, quotes from him.
Yeah, so he would do his music or his movie reviews constantly, and then occasionally he would just throw in an article about how much he loves Steak and Shake that they would pull quotes from. And one of them, which is my absolute favorite quote, which is, if I had dinner with the president, I would take him to Steak and Shake. And he would be delighted.
He would just be so happy.
I also want to know what president it was. Like, because I imagine it being Bill Clinton. He's like, all right.
Okay, let's do it.
Yeah, let's do it. Okay, ready? We're all going to do our Bill Clinton impressions for this joke.
I think is interesting is that old men will often refer to themselves as like an old romantic. Yeah. I'm just an old romantic.
That was a pretty good...
No one ever says... I'm just an old sleazeball. No, there's I forgot the joke. Never mind.
I believe in you.
All right.
I had a joke that I thought of today, and I was like, this is the perfect way to work it in.
Oh, my gosh. Elijah. Oh.
No,
he's already started.
Let's get on food for a sec.
Thank you.
Elijah's been waiting patiently.
Shame.
Since I just want to go around, I think this would be fun. This is just an idea I thought of seconds ago.
Nice. So this will be well developed.
Let's just go around and give like brief descriptions of every person in this room.
All right.
What?
Do we want to do...
So it would be like the group discussed, like just talking about it, like the other three. You know what
so
I mean?
So we're just going to talk about each other in
but
very
like,
descriptive ways.
Yeah, we're just going to describe, like, or maybe, like, just their general personality so they can understand more during this podcast.
All right. Let's start with you.
Yeah, I should have saw that coming.
Yeah. First of all, Italian.
Yep.
Now, you can't see it, but she is currently baking a lasagna.
I'm always baking.
Just always baking a lasagna. She still has a flag for El Duce, the former Italian dictator. She waves it every day in front of our faces. It's crazy how Italian she is.
Very, very Italian.
She loves Martin Scorsese.
Yep.
It's great.
Uh-huh.
No. No questions? All right.
No
we'll just
questions.
Keep describing.
Yeah.
She also, is an outgoing kind of person. And not a kind of person, like, ooh, she's an outgoing kind of person. She's outgoing
kind of. That's actually, like, a perfect description of me.
She is a person, though.
Yes.
I am a person.
Yeah. Very important note, person. Elijah, how would you describe Lauren?
Yeah.
Very warm. And,
like at least 98.6 degrees.
Very female.
Very female.
Well, like, slightly female.
Yes.
What?
Ooh. Like,
but,
you're your own woman.
You know what? Woman. You're just a person. I don't even think, I don't know why I brought up gender. That was the second thing I thought of. Very offensive. I'm offended.
I don't know. You didn't go on about her nationality.
Funny, you're very Italian.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm sorry.
That's the safe place to go, is ethnicity.
It feels just like maybe... Did you swim in high school?
Oh my god.
Did you swim?
You remind me of like when hot chocolate gets cold and you warm it up in the microwave.
What?
But what type of hot chocolate?
That feels
though?
Like an insult.
It feels like an insult. It's like it used to be what you wanted.
Yeah.
No. It's like still warm and satisfying.
But it's old?
But it's not brand new. And it was a second thought.
I'm not gonna shit with you, Lauren. I'm not gonna, like, pump up your ego.
No, I don't want...
Fresh hot chocolate.
I could never... I just aspire to be fresh hot chocolate.
And you're getting there.
I'm getting there. I'm already... I'm not the cold hot chocolate.
No, you're lukewarm hot chocolate. Rewarmed.
Well, how is it rewarmed? I'm gonna guess in a microwave.
No, on the...
Ooh,
oh, so there's some care put into it.
Still... Fresh.
Oh.
Yeah.
So it's like somebody made hot chocolate.
They bought a hot chocolate and they put it in the fridge.
Oh,
and
why?
It got a little lukewarm.
Why did they put it in the
it's
fridge?
It's not cold yet because they wanted to run upstairs and they thought, I'll drink it later.
Yeah, it was way too
and
hot.
And you know what you do when you have a hot chocolate that you want to drink later? You put it in the fridge.
Well, the milk, you don't want the milk to go bad.
That's true.
No. Yeah, it's all true. These are true facts.
Look,
all I just
I'm
say.
Just painting a word picture of how Lauren makes me feel.
On the inside. Well, now that Elijah has given this great description,
Elijah.
Let's go to Elijah. I have three descriptors that I have. The first of was one I think I said that I was saving for the roast, is a more depressing Woody Allen. That's one.
Yeah.
Wes Anderson, if he wanted to make me kill myself. I had another one the other day that I couldn't think of. But then, I'm not going to say the other one, just because I said you're a Wes Anderson that makes me suicidal. I want to lay off. You know. But I did also say earlier today, like 3 hours ago, Elijah was my favorite roommate.
Yeah. It's on the canon.
It's canon.
It means less now.
Elijah's one of the funniest people I've like you can talk to
he's
that will
people.
Also make you sad.
Yeah.
In the
as you
same
saw
sentence.
About the hot chocolate analogy.
It's
Lauren
like,
laughed, but she did
laughed.
Feel worse about herself.
I laughed, but I'm like, oh man, I'm not even chocolate milk or hot chocolate. I'm like neither of those things.
You've been used.
My
yeah.
parents taught me not to love anything. And this is just a repercussion.
A repercussion of it. Archie, how would you describe Elijah after that barrage of compliments that he gave
him? I'm also going to use the analogy.
The analogy?
Yeah. So, like, it's Harry Potter.
Yeah.
But if instead of becoming, like, the hero, he just internalized all of his everything that went bad and just became very, very sad. Yes.
Oh my god.
Oh man.
I think you're great. I think you're great. But you just seem very
warm, optimistic person. I don't know where this is coming from.
You're like hot chocolate that's been microwaved.
No, I haven't been microwaved.
No. I don't think you've been microwaved. You have some hope.
No,
you're
it's like chocolate milk that it's been sitting there for a little bit, but it's still good to drink.
You were chocolate milk that was converted into hot chocolate. It was
yeah.
It's not natural. It shouldn't be there. It knows what it is, but it's still hot.
You still drink it.
You still drink
yeah,
it.
You're still gonna drink
it. And then if you wanna have it later, you put it in the fridge. For later. All right. We'll just keep going around the circle. Let's go to Argy. All right, everybody, pull out.
He reminds me of Jack Black.
I'll take it. My roommates say Adam Devine all the time.
I
see that one a lot.
I'm going to think of let's say if a balloon that is letting out air and flying across the room had a personality. That's what it would be. That also played Shrek and Shrek the Musical.
I could. RG's like one of those people that can make you laugh but mad at the same time.
He's like
Elijah makes me laugh and sad and Archie just makes me like, but stop.
Yeah. I remember he took my water bottle.
And then he drank all of it.
And I was like, kind of pissed off.
But also, it was a funny bit.
He reminds me of, like, a panda in the enclosure that is just starts fucking with all the other pandas.
Yeah.
Because he's bored.
Yeah. But it's still a panda.
But
it's
yeah.
A panda. It's still a panda.
He's
still
a little
love
smarter
it.
Than the other pandas. And realizes yeah. He's in an enclosure.
No. I like that. I like that comparison. Yeah. RG, how do you feel about these assignments?
I think... I'll take them. You yeah. know? I'll run with it.
You're... Oh no! He's flying across the room, and he's also singing selections from Shrek the Musical that we can't clear because of copyrights.
My favorite thing that you did was the banana thing.
Where the banana just, thing.
You said you can't guess how many bananas I have in my bag, and you started tossing them out.
I think 12.
You'll never know.
We'll
never
like, know. I thought it was upwards of 15.
Upwards of 15.
There was more than 12.
Some people guess 20.
Mm-hmm.
I'm never gonna tell though. For people who don't know, I'm sure everyone who's listening to this probably knows, but, so we had to...
plus, no.
What?
I was gonna say, maybe my mom.
Maybe my mom.
Maybe my mom.
Huh.
Elijah, is your mom gonna listen to this?
Hell no. I swear.
Sorry, Mom, if you're listening. So we had to describe ourselves in an Onion-esque headline, and, mine was... You'll never guess how many bananas I have in my backpack. And then I handed out bananas that were in my backpack. And I never told anyone how many were in there.
And there was quite a lot.
There was a lot of
it. It got to the point where, like, there can't be more bananas in there.
But there were. And you'll never know how many.
We'll never know.
We'll never know.
There is one person who knows. It's not me.
Travis?
Mm-mm.
And it's me. James Wagner, the next person to be described.
I've got a good one for you.
All right, here
like,
we go.
You're like a banana peel that has gained consciousness, and you're trying to find some cylindrical objects that you can fit on, and you get into semantics, James.
I get into some silly antics. Silly banantics.
Banantics. Boo. Yeah.
I see James as like one of those inflatable
yeah.
things that like in front of like
yeah
in front of like the car dealerships, but mm-hmm. like if it thought it was funny.
Ooh. Oh, Lauren! I only said you were Italian. Jeez.
No, I obviously think no, like the personality. Never mind.
I think
no, there's no way
a better descriptor would be the wacky waving inflatable tube man that also knew what the rule of three was.
There you go.
Yeah, see?
There it is. You fixed
You're
it.
You're like a sock you edited. Puppet that would do cocaine if it could.
I thought of one for myself. Have you ever seen that video of the guy shoveling snow and then falling
yeah.
for 12 seconds straight?
That's like your whole life.
That's my whole life. And it also, all of the body language... That's me speaking. Though I
yeah.
did, in
He's
my...
He's curled into a ball right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, in my... I'm slowly falling for the next hour. But there is a girl that was in my film class, and I speak with my hands. Like, I do that. I do that fairly regularly. But every single thing she said had a hand movement. Like, imagine you pantomiming a hand movement that made no sense for what she was saying... That's what she was doing. So let me give you a short little monologue and make up hand movements for it that have nothing to
this
do with it.
This is a great bit for a podcast.
Yeah, ready,
James?
Guys? So today I realized that my cockroach, not my pet, but just lived in my apartment. The end. Now imagine, you know, for the cockroach, you might do like a little scurrying thing with your hands. No, she would like raise her hands up and then like praise Jesus. Like it made no sense, none of her hand motions.
I got a cockroach.
Also, notice how I deflected the talk about me by talking about somebody
oh,
else.
Yeah.
We're not dumb.
We're
oh,
not
no,
dumb.
I'm sure, I'm sure. I'm sure. Any more fine compliments?
If I had a family...
If you had a...
Well, like,
shout out to Archie's mom in the beginning.
If I had children.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I was walking down the street, and I saw James walking towards us. I'd probably usher them across.
I thought you were going to say, if I had a family, and I needed to leave one behind in the fire...
It would be James.
It would be James.
Well...
Because he is very... He's self-dependent. Yeah. He's resourceful.
He can.
I really want to
I'm also flame retardant. Lauren, I cannot catch on fire.
You are. You are.
And also, but, I shouldn't say that word.
You are just the freshest hot chocolate.
Oh, aww. I graduated to fresh hot chocolate.
Okay, now let's, based on our analogies, let's all apologize to each other. You know what? You're only moderately Italian.
I'm literally only 50% Italian. Yeah.
Elijah, I said some choice words. You do have a frailing optimism that is found in Woody Allen that you even push further.
You're
Woody Allen with some more realism.
You know what I hate about the Woody Allen comparisons, though? Is that no one likes Woody Allen anymore.
Yeah, you're like comparing you to like Bill Cosby.
Yeah.
I was going to say something about that with you. But aside not to.
Please.
My apology would be that,
I have to pee.
Oh, okay.
And I want to apologize for that.
Okay.
Okay. What do you want us to do about that?
Well, I also wanted to say that James reminded me of one of those porta potties.
What?
But classier. He's like a porta potty.
Oh, like that one that has a sink.
And it's really nice, like at Jungle Gym.
But it's still a porta potty.
No, but it's like a classy porta potty. It has abstract art on the outside.
Nice, yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, I like it.
Never seen one of those.
I just said that because I need
you're
to
like
keep...
if they made
you're the classiest toilet I've ever met, yeah. James. And you're not even a toilet. You're like a spa. And RG, you're wonderful. You're fantastic. you have eyes that are just like, I look at them and I say, wow,
Those are
some damn eyes.
I never thought about that
before. They make me feel better when I see you doing your thing, you know?
I like this character that Elijah has slipped into.
It almost reminds me of Bernie Sanders.
Almost. A little bit.
Do you have a Bernie Sanders impression?
Just right in your pocket.
We need to raise taxes on the millionaires and billionaires to pay for a nice bathroom for James and RG. And Lauren to drink a hot chocolate in.
Just he connected everything.
The freshest hot chocolate.
Oh, wow. Combining all of
and
the
products. And it's such a nice bathroom. If you wanted to do a cooking show in it, you could.
Oh, even more. Is there one more thing you could connect? I think that's all.
I think you hit every topic.
And if you want to host a rambling podcast with no point or theme.
Ooh, he's really hit the nail on the head.
You could do it in this bathroom because it's used to a lot of shit.
So you're saying we shouldn't be doing it in this bathroom?
Oh, yeah.
We really...
If we were in a bathroom, would I need to pee?
Yeah.
Well, you might have to pee.
We also wasted a lot of money on making this bathroom soundproof.
I like this accent because I can be...
Yeah.
I'm just going to maintain the accent.
I like it. Let's see how far... We're going to play a game called 10 out of 10. It's a pretty famous game.
Yeah.
That we
it's a
have.
Segment we have.
It's a segment, a regularly occurring segment that has not occurred yet.
If I may, you're all 10s out of 10s.
You may. So 10 out of 10 works, and you guys at home can play. If you wanna.
Tweet at us.
Yeah, tweet after the end of this. Tweet at us yes or no. You'll figure out why. Or just do it right now with no regard.
Yeah. Yes or no.
Yes or
no. We wanna know.
I'll start it off.
Yeah.
Think of a 10 out of 10 person.
For you.
Romantically. So, they like doing the laundry. Maybe that's a thing. Or they let you do the laundry if you're into that. I don't know why, but hey, it's 2016. All that sort of stuff. 10 out of 10 person. But, they have a fatal flaw. Stuff we've done before is they have cups for hands. They have peanut butter for hair.
Yeah.
Wait, what? So, yes. They're a 10 out of 10.
Except for that
Except
flaw.
For one thing. So, like... I mean, some have argued that, like,
what
this thing
okay
makes
with?
Them not a 10 out of 10, but let's not look
let's
at
not get
that
into the
logic.
Semantic of it.
They're your perfect ideal match, except for, like, this one thing, and then you have to decide if it's worth it.
If it's worth it. And then you'll also, people will be asking questions about it, and the person who asks the original 10 out of 10, at any moment they can call, stop questions, nothing that gets answered is part of the actual character, and we will say yes or no, whether we would date, marry, all that sort of stuff them, or avoid it.
What if we renamed it to cancel all that confusion?
Mm-hmm.
To 10 out of 10, if not for blank.
We'll call Hasbro and see if they will change the title. Also, not owned by Hasbro. Please don't sue.
I have to say that.
Yeah, we have to say that legally.
In every podcast.
In every podcast.
We don't even bring them up.
We haven't even talked about the last three. I hope those get don't take it down.
What? I hope those get don't take it down.
Alright. 10 out of 10. But they call doors dares.
Okay, so they understand what doors are.
They know what doors are.
Okay.
And they call doors dares. Like, hey,
so,
hon,
like,
can you open up that dare? Yeah, like the drug program.
Yeah.
It's an acronym. They think it's an acronym.
They think it's an acronym for drug awareness. I shouldn't have started this. Drug awareness.
Really exciting.
Really exciting.
Yes,
program.
Drug awareness. I can't speak. Drug awareness, really exciting, is what DOORS stand for.
I'm gonna look
but
it
it's
up.
Pronounced there.
Oh, I get this game now.
So,
yeah, I don't care.
You don't care? You just want the touch of a human woman, I'm assuming.
No, no.
Drug abuse resistance education.
It's pretty close.
We want to make sure our podcast is educational.
100% factual.
I think they're only really a 10 out of 10 if you, like, love them, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so it does... this sounds, like, really dumb and mushy. But, like, I don't think any of these characteristics... Unless they were, like... You know, for them to be a 10 out of 10 necessarily includes any abstraction would be acceptable.
All right, all questions
done. You have
done.
To like him enough
all
to say, well, she's
done.
A neo-Nazi.
But
that's okay with me.
Only Elijah.
All questions are done. Game canceled forever. All right, so yes or no.
See, it
you?
Only took Elijah hearing one option
one 10
to
out
just
of 10.
Discredit the whole game.
He literally went, oh, I get it. Let me destroy this game forever. A more depressing Woody Allen.
It's not...
What were you going to say?
I don't know what I was going to say.
He just got real sad.
He just got real sad.
Why does everything have to be sad? I'm not sad. I'm very happy. I'm in a good mood.
Elijah,
right now.
Put that gun down. He's pointed his
this
gun.
This is as happy as I can be. If you think that's sad, that depresses
stop.
Me.
He's juggling his guns. He has three guns and he's juggling them.
You know
them.
What I think? I think if I go to a therapist.
He clapped in the middle of juggling.
I think if I go to a therapist, there better be something wrong with me. Because if this is normal, that's a problem.
I need a second.
All right, we'll take our patented 1 second break.
Okay, I'm gonna pee now. Okay. I'm gonna text you guys. You can let me back in.
Yeah, all right. So there's gonna be a part where he gets. Oh my gosh.
I have no idea where to go from.
There's nowhere to go. Is there any? We could talk about. So Elijah has just gone to the bathroom, just in case some of the other stuff gets cut. So we could talk about video. Video sketch right now, because we have our, for the sketch comedy group that we're in, we have the director of production,
that's
Archie
me.
Barton, with us. So
basically what happens is that we get an idea for sketch, and we film it all, and then we're like, hey, Archie, and we just send him all the film, and we make him do it.
Most of the time, don't even include the script. You just have to gather what
is it together.
I think there's
a good amount of like I remember the one time I sent him the footage and he texted me like, hey, can you like give me more information? And I was like, yeah, sorry. Yeah, do you want to talk about editing?
Yeah.
Or can you just start with what got you into video production?
Well, I'm kind of an original YouTube fan. Mm-hmm. Been watching YouTube since I was in elementary school, and I was
same.
Always like, hey, I want to do that. And so in elementary school, my first camera was a little Kodak point-and-shoot camera that also did video.
My sister has one of those, yeah.
Yeah, they're great, in quotation marks. But, yeah, you couldn't edit those either.
No.
So they're basically one-take videos, and... So we did those.
Yeah, I remember in high school, sophomore year, I took Spanish 2, and we got to do Spanish 1. We did a video about, like, ordering food, like, ¿Dónde está la,
Biblioteca.
Biblioteca. Great place to get food. but, like, ordering, stuff like that. And we had to do a video for it, and we shot the video, and then we're like, how do we edit this thing? Like, none of us had... We could have done it in Windows Movie Maker. Like, we totally could have done it. But the thing that we had had its own proprietary, like, thing to hook up to a computer, and we didn't have that.
Nice.
And so what we did is we put it onto a DVD, like, all the footage onto a DVD, went through, and it divided it into scenes. And so we deleted the scenes we knew we weren't going to do, and then we burned it onto another DVD by playing the scenes and cutting the recording at specific times, so that way we got the edits. And there is, we wanted to do this thing where the server did the food, like, gave the food, and so somebody did, somebody flipped the, like, the piece of bread to get them, and they tried to get it to land right on the table, right as it cut. So it's this really cool effect, and it's so easy to do it now, because in Adobe Premiere, you just hit the arrow key so you get to the frame, cut it, cut or it. Press O for out, and then you've got it. But with this, I had to press stop on the DVD recorder, and it took me like 8 tries. And since it was all linear, I couldn't go back. I had to do the entire video each time. And it took me about 2 hours just to get that one shot.
That... I mean, I kind of want to applaud you for that, because that's like, that's original filmmaking.
That's like, that is very comparable to the original. Yeah, it really is. Looking at you, burning it onto stuff.
Maybe even more intricate, honestly.
Cinematically, it's my favorite shot.
Yeah. I would believe so.
What is your creative process when...
Oh, Elijah's taking over. Go ahead. Sorry. No, go ahead.
There's a real tug of war power going on right now.
Creative process. Is that it? What was your question?
The thing. Okay. I was just trying to. Much like I. James insulted my small talk once. And this was a small talk thing. I was going to ask about your creative process and, like, how you come up with story ideas. But you've already discussed that probably on the podcast.
The first one.
See, I tried to get out of this, and you keep bringing it up, Lauren. You want me to ask a question? It's not a good conversation topic.
I think.
How old were you when you first got an erection?
I'll go first.
Lauren, care to answer that one for all of us?
I'm gonna go with 12.
For all of us? I'll never tell.
I actually do have a question, which is, I'm interested in the difference between, one of the things I noticed going into the podcast was that once the mic was on, we all maybe took on a somewhat comedic persona. So what is the difference between you alone and your comedic persona? How did you develop your comedic persona? And how do you differentiate between the two? Do you have a comedic persona?
I think what we had talked about when we did the descriptors, when you guys said, you know, wacky waving inflatable tube man, I mean, that when people say that's what you do, you kind of play to your strengths.
Yeah.
That when I'm on stage, if somebody needs to go all out, I'll be one of those people that just goes absolutely insane. If you need somebody to talk with their hands, I'll talk with my hands. If you didn't see the podcast,
he was talking with his hands.
I just pointed at myself with my thumb.
I thought you were going to make something else up.
But I feel like a lot of what people will tell me about my stuff, I try to play to that. And that's where I've kind of developed. Because before I came to the Sundial, I'm sure some of us were kind of the funny person in the friend group. That they were just like, oh, he makes me laugh type deal. And so there was no real like, oh, you're this type. But when you get, especially with the Sundial, with Backburner, you get in a group with a bunch of people who are funny, and you start being...
It's just a struggle to be the funniest.
You also start seeing the subdivisions of how people are funny. Some people are very funny in a quiet way. Some people are just always on. Some people can turn it off and on when they need to, stuff like that. And it's very... When you get into those groups, you can kind of see where your role is.
I think... Well, going off of, like... I don't think I was ever really, like, the funny friend growing up. I feel like maybe I was the more laid back one, and that's kind of was similar to that, but also I was also like the mom of my friend group. Like I was the one that, like, if my friends did something wrong, which this got into a whole thing, I would get really mad at them, but if they did something wrong, they would apologize to me. as if like I was disappointed in them, and I'm like, I had every time I'd be like, I don't care. Like, I don't know. Like, they would like legitimately like sit me down and apologize.
Like, I don't want to give
specific examples. And it wasn't
even things like that they did directly to you.
No. But it was also a thing where it was like, I don't know why you feel like you need to apologize to me because I'm your friend.
See, now what you forgot was that this was during the time that you were a priest.
Yeah,
so I this was a might priest. Have been a confessional. Was there a divider between you? You know
what? I did sprinkle holy water on it.
Yeah, you were a man of the cloth during this period.
But as far as like comedic personas, because that was like the actual question.
Yeah,
I think I'm still developing my comedic persona.
Yeah,
definitely in performance I am. For writing comedy, I think I have a pretty strong grasp on the tone that I typically write. I mean, someone can correct me if I'm wrong, if I seem all over the place. But I feel like I have a pretty consistent idea of, like, what I am as a writer. But as a performer, I'm like, because I took, guys, I took classes at Second City.
What? Ooh, add that to the tally.
I don't think I've brought that up on the podcast yet.
A tally's got to start somewhere.
James was in theater in high school.
Ooh, James was in theater.
Add that to the tally.
We did already mention my swimming because of Archie. Oh,
so many tallies.
Elijah was a mob boss when he was a child.
Yep.
Actually, slightly true. I had a girl's arm broken in second grade.
Okay.
All right, let's divulge into that story.
Hold on.
Oh, that's all.
Okay, no, that's all he'll give us. Like how James described me. I am a outgoing kind of question mark, because I'm typically very shy until I'm comfortable with someone or in a group of people, which is why when I join OUTV, that is not the kind of personality I joined with the Sundial. With the Sundial is the kind of person who sat in the back, didn't say anything, and now I should be stopped. Truthfully, should be stopped. But what I found when I was like performing was I was way more physical in my improv than I ever thought I would. Going into it, and that really surprised me. Like, if anyone, like, there was a scene where, like, there's two people doing a scene, and they, like, mention this waitress that was, like, off, like, kind of off screen, that was, like, trying to, like, be flirtatious, so then I was like, alright, and I immediately started, being, overtly sexual on the sideline. And then there's another time we did this scene, which I kind of want to bring to back burner for an improv scene, but it's kind of difficult, where there's, like, five different characters, and each person starts off doing, like, a very specific character, and, you have to make that character very distinct, and then you rotate, so you have to do every character that's there, and you have to remember what each character is like, and the one girl, there was, like, me and her, and but our age, and then there was two other people our age, everyone else was older. The other two people were, the one acted like, they were both versions of middle schoolers, which was weird because we were, like, in college. But the one was, like, the middle schooler that, like, is, like, acts too young. Like, it's like, okay. Like, all of her characters were either children or an old lady, and that was the only thing that she could do. The other one was the middle schooler who, like, is nice to your face but is a total bitch behind your back. Those were the two girls. And the one of them started the character scene where we had to rotate as a little kid. And what she did, part of that, was her physically rotating on the chair so that she was sitting, like, with her legs over the back of the chair and, like, her head backwards. And, like, she kept, like, spinning around. And then as soon as I got to this her position, I'm like, well, I gotta do it. And so then I did it. And it was like, I did not expect myself to be that physical of a performer, but also an improviser. Like, I just kind of went right into it, and that surprised me. So I'm still figuring out my comedic persona as more of a performer, I would say. That was way too long of an answer.
Quickly, I do want to explain that I did not have a girl's arm broken in second grade. I had a crush on a girl, and I had a group of boys chase her, and she broke her arm. It's just...
I don't know, that kind of sounds like you had a girl's arm
broken. Yeah. Yeah.
It was similar.
Wait, hold on.
Is okay, that what wait, you told hold on, the police?
Can I ask a question?
Group of guys chase
Why her. Did you think that was going to work?
I was in second grade.
Ooh, he has oh, okay.
All right, no, fair enough.
And I became very antisocial after that.
I thought you were going to say anti-Semitic.
I also, my favorite part of that story is that I had another kid apologize for me. I had him go to the... Anyway, terrible story.
What about your comedic persona? Well, I feel like you have a very strong one.
I do have... I think so. Like, that's why it kind of bothers me when people say I'm, like, a more depressing Woody Allen. Like, I do think it's funny, but because that isn't... I feel my actual personality, that's very much a comedic persona, because I don't think my actual personality is very
funny. Right, no. We were talking more of, like, what...
Yeah, yeah, I understand. Yeah. But you know what I mean?
Cause, like, you don't... Like, yeah, I get it.
I start thinking, well, that's the impression I give to people when I meet them, is that I'm a very, cynical and...
We've also only seen you in a comedic aspect until probably recently.
Yeah.
But...
One of my first impressions of you was we were at Lynn's Fruit Farms, and it was one of the first times you actually talked to me, and you walked up, and you're like, there's too many people. And I was like, yeah, this is a pretty crowded fruit store right now. And you're like, no, on Earth. And then you just walked away.
He's not wrong.
He's not wrong. Yeah, there is a lot of people. But, so, like, that's, I laughed very hard, but it was also like,
it's a bit of a crutch, though. What? I often wish my comedic persona was more like Stephen Colbert or, like, Colin Gossel. He has that great quality of being, like, very energetic and up and, like, uplifting in the way he makes jokes.
But I think...
Which is enviable.
What your I don't want to say shtick, but, like, your persona is... It makes it funnier because you look like this little innocent kid, and then you'll say some... I don't want to say heinous.
Right. Well,
some inappropriate things. And that's why it makes it so much funnier coming from your mouth.
I should say I'm not complaining that is the perception.
Okay.
I'm aware of it. But I'm saying, and I think this is true of anyone if they're putting on a character, so I would imagine it's true of all of you, is somewhat wanting to balance the two, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You want to, if I'm writing a piece, I want it to be funny and I want it to have these comedic elements, but I also want to convey something about myself, right? And that's why I think I do longer pieces, is because I can kind of put a little bit of my actual opinion into it while still maintaining a comedic structure. But, like, I think that is an interesting duality that we tend to have. If there's a difference between what you're kind of presenting and your actual opinion on a matter.
I don't know. I feel like...
But I think we feel that, it doesn't have to be a comedic persona, but, like, I think in any given situation... One of the things I've found is that I used to think, well, I'm not funny around my parents because I'm being my self when I'm trying. How do I put this? I used to not realize that the reason I wasn't funny in certain contexts, like work and with my parents, is because I was trying to make a certain impression. But I've learned that it's very much dictated by your audience, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if they are responding to a certain type of humor, you double down on that, and you start playing to that. And I think it's interesting, because stand-ups talk about stand-up being a conversation a lot, and I think it's really interesting how an audience can shape your shtick in a way, like the material you use.
I think, like, I definitely have different personalities for the different types of people that I'm around.
Yeah.
I think that's what you were saying, kind of, going solely kind of based off that. If you were around in the Sundial, pre me being an officer and post me being an officer, that was, I don't know if you would recognize it. Your freshman year, I was not an officer.
Yeah.
But I feel like I went through a very drastic change between that summer. Mm-hmm. Because I was I straight up would only go to meetings if Travis was with me. I would not... The only time I did was because I was walking home and ran into Ben. And Ben was like, you going to the meeting? And I was like, no. And he was like, come on. And I was like, okay. And he was like, walk. But, like, I...
And then they got married 4 years after that.
Yeah, we're still waiting. But, like, I did not talk, sat in the back. So it was, like, as soon as I... Even, like... Before I was running for office, I was like, no one's going to vote for me because no one even really... Because I remember they used to do this thing where they would take a bunch of characters and list, like, who in the Sundown was, like, most like that character, like the Harry Potter or...
Like casting list.
Like casting list. I was always barely in them, and when I was, it was me paired with Travis. So, like, we were, like, the Weasley twins.
Yeah.
I don't remember their names. Someone's gonna...
Ron and Hermione. Yeah, the twins.
So, like,
makes that subplot really weird.
So I was, like, barely... I was barely included in that because everyone... I was so quiet people would forget about me. And then as soon as I was, like, elected as an officer, I think that kind of, like, validated, like, oh, I guess these people kind of like me.
Yeah.
And then my actual personality came through after that, where I felt more comfortable just talking in front of people. And now it got to the point where, like, when I lead general meetings, I'm not nervous at all. So, and that's a very, very... I never read a piece that I wrote at a meeting until last year. Fun fact.
Ooh.
Never did.
Interesting. Yeah, that's... I mean, for me personally, I don't have much fear of public speaking, right? Like, it is nonchalant. Like, I've gone into classes like, oh, I'm doing a presentation today. Well, we'll see how that goes. Like, there's no nervousness to it whatsoever. But I also understand why that can be so nerve-wracking, yeah. Going into, like, the idea of reading. Like, I get more nervous reading a piece than I do almost anything else. Is that because it's such, like, a personal thing that it's this very... It becomes a very vulnerable thing, especially if I like the piece. Yeah. Sometimes I'll, like... I'm in a class right now where we literally write for, like, 2 or 3 minutes, and then we'll... share the piece, and no comments about the piece, just a thank you for being approval, and so it's this very, like, open place to say it, but at somewhere like a Sundown meeting, which is still a very open place, I mean, the first biggest rule is community, and we are very supportive, compared to, I'm sure, a lot of other places, very supportive of each other.
Comparative to OUTV, who get mad at us. For doing bits in the
group. To be fair, they are not a comedic organization.
And also, to be fair, I'm sure that's so annoying.
And so...
Sorry if for some reason you're listening.
The better place, there is still an expectation for it to go over well, right? That I've read a piece in front of a meeting before, and it gets moderate laughter. And I've remembered times where I've read a piece that got more laughter, and I'll immediately compare it to that.
Yeah.
And that's what makes me nervous when I... So, class presentations, whatever, doing, like, sketch comedy. If I've written it, then there is some nervousness to it, but I know that I have other people to support me, that they're going to fail with me. That's the idea of improv. But with that, presenting a paper in front of people, I totally understand why it makes people nervous. Yeah.
I'm better with conversations, with presentations. Like, the one time a class, we had to present for 6 minutes, and I just taught it into a lesson, like I was teaching, and I did so well that my teacher made me not... stop at 6 minutes, and I was like, oh god. She also liked me for, I don't know why, I hated her so much. But anyways,
shout out.
I don't remember her name, I straight up don't.
Let's go with Miss Bilbo Baggins.
That was actually her name!
That was a lot of build up to the worst possible response.
So, what was your comedic, do you have a comedic persona,
Archie? I think Archie 100% has a comedic personality. Or persona.
Yeah. Because we've seen it on, like, 99% of the time. Also seen that, like, 1% where either you're really tired, you're really stressed, or it's just not on for whatever reason.
Think of all the times he didn't give people bananas, but he had.
Oh my gosh. All those missed opportunities.
Yeah, I'd say for the most part, I'm usually on. I feel like if I had to describe it, I'd have more of, like, there's a serious persona that I take on. I feel like my comedic persona is the majority. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and which is something I realized recently and something which made me realize that I'll probably never succeed in academics. Like, if I wanted to go into a career in academics, I wouldn't be able to take it seriously.
Is that why you dropped out of neuroscience?
Yeah, I used to be a neuroscience major, and I just don't want to play that game anymore, you know? Yeah. I'd rather entertain people.
And you're honestly, like, you're so good at it.
Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, if you listen to the performance podcast, we just raved on how great you were.
Yeah.
For, like, the whole thing.
It kind of made me tear up a little bit.
Really?
I think, like, watching the Backburner show, you have an ability to take a scene and elevate it, even if the material's like a little weak. I mean, mm-hmm. not that the material's weak, but you can
but no.
really like.
Oh no, some of those were first drafts.
And really like blow it up into a full blown character. And yeah. even if you're doing like some stupid shtick at a meeting where you're throwing up bananas, you fully commit
yeah.
to it. Which is,
I feel like you're our Keenan, where it's like if a sketch is like it's almost there, we'll just put Archie in it,
yeah.
and it'll immediately be better.
You guys are so nice to
me. And now it's the meantime. Archie, you remind me of a pumpkin that's gone bad.
Oh, man.
Archie, you're a bowling ball that's flat.
Oh, man, that's a bad bowling ball.
That makes no sense.
It's just like a heavy square.
Yeah.
And this is why James dropped out of academia.
This is why I also dropped out from a physics major.
Guys, I was going to teach the youth of America.
Oh, my gosh.
I was an education major.
Yes.
I could see you teaching people, but teaching them comedy. You like teaching people comedy.
Yeah. It's like, it's one of those things where I knew I would love teaching, but it was one of those things where I was like, I would never be fulfilled if I didn't at least try. My ideal job is a head writer of something where I can still have like that position where I can help lead but also be way more creative.
I have a question because it seems to me that all of you want to go into comedy, so I'm curious.
Yeah.
Or like be a head writer, which is similar.
Well, yeah, I want to go into
but
comedy.
Do you feel like you would be unfulfilled if you did anything like in the structured world, or is it more that you don't think you could? I couldn't be sane if I worked at like a company, or
I,
is it that you just feel that urge
I could
to create?
Be sane. I knew I wouldn't be happy if I went straight from college to just, because my original goal was graduate and then go get a job at a high school somewhere teaching English, and then write on the side. And I knew, one, I probably would never actually do that, because teaching is a crap ton of work for how
yeah.
little money you get.
It's a full-time job.
Yeah. yeah. And then, so one, that would just be stressful to try and, like, do both of those at the same time, and also, like, lessons plans. And I knew I would love the work, so I knew I could get a job teaching high school right out of college and live an okay life for the rest of my life. But I knew, like, deep down, I would be disgusted with myself.
You'd always ask the what if.
Like, what if I just moved to Chicago? Or what if I, like, sent in that spec script? Like, I would always have that in the back of my mind. So it's not like I don't think I would be fulfilled. Like, if I try and I'm unsuccessful, I'll be okay.
Yeah.
But it's that I couldn't live not knowing. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. And for me, it's the reason I switched majors from, I was computer science major and now film studies, is with a focus in screenwriting, because I like, as much as I love comedy, and I love comedy, I love all the ins and outs of it, I also like regular film. I love TV. I love mm-hmm. television, love television writing. I would, as much as satisfied as I would be writing for a comedy, I would also be insanely satisfied writing for a drama.
Yes.
Writing for procedural, writing movies, anything like that. And that I just like visual narrative writing.
I'm just imagining a Mad Men episode where the toaster comes to life.
And it's smoking a cigarette.
You want to blow
well,
down.
Archie, do you want to go into comedy or video editing?
Wow, that's very topical. because I've been kind of thinking about that a lot this week after the Second City show. I'd never seen a Second City show, but after seeing that, it's literally everything I like.
Yeah.
It's comedy.
It was.
Singing.
It's performance.
It's performance.
It's crowd work.
Yeah.
It's all this sort of stuff. It's improv.
Like,
it's,
you were joking that they were going to hire you right there. I'm sure if you could have just walked right up on them. And they'd be like, yeah, you fit right in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Archie, you were so good in the show.
Thank you.
You have the exact right personality for improv.
Thank you.
Like, in terms of, You can
this
pick
just
up
became
just
title
it the
Archie is great part two.
Inflate my ego, please.
Yeah. Inflategate Archie style.
But yeah, so after that, like, I mean, it's only been a few days, but every night I'm just like, I think I just want to move to Chicago when I graduate and try that out. And my fallback plan is film, which
same thing.
That's safe.
I feel like it's easier to get a job in post production than like
pre production writing stuff.
Mid production writing.
That's the worst probably stage to be in.
But no, it's all of our goals. Pretty risky.
What's
pretty
your
pie in the sky?
What's my goal? I don't know. I think mainly right now, like I quit my job recently on the second day at this law firm because I just thought if I was like I looked around, I don't want to say this because it's very mean, but and I'm sure they love it, but like I just thought if I was doing this at 30, I'd kill myself, and all of them were 30 and doing that, and I was like I can't be around that.
Yeah, it's like that office like. Oh. Like infrastructure kind of bumps you out.
Yeah, it's soul crushing. Mm-hmm. And like my fallback plan, which is as difficult to go into as stand up or comedy in any regard, film is like to go into academics.
Yeah,
which is as hard and poorly paid.
Yeah,
and
unless you hit like that sweet spot.
Yeah,
and in the same thing with comedy or any type of performance, it's unless you hit that sweet spot, you're gonna be struggling.
Well, Archie, like, I don't feel like you have to decide between editing and performing. Because especially, like even Britannic or Derek Comedy, like, they're making videos on their own, and they're in them. They need someone to edit them.
That's why I love my role in Backburner.
Yeah.
Just because, Backburner sketch comedy.
Yeah. Plug.
Always. But yeah, that's...
Because you also get we give you a fair amount of creative control with the editing. That's... Possibly, if we just had somebody who knew how to edit, we'd be a little bit more tighter, and we would probably be involved a lot in a lot heavier aspect. We'd probably actually give them the script to edit.
Not just, do what you want.
Good luck.
Speaking of do what you want, I think it's going to be time to
wrap up.
But what I want to do is give everybody, before plugs, 15 seconds to just say whatever they want. All right, we'll go in a circle starting with Eli, and I'll call it, and you get 15 seconds to just say whatever you want, all right? And then we'll get into plugs. All right, 3, 2, 1, go.
I would just like to apologize to any viewer that had to listen to my voice for this duration of time. And, somewhere over the rainbow.
We can't clear that next person. So I never got to compliment everyone when we went back and did the compliments. So these are my compliments. Elijah, Harry Potter's really cool. James, you're like a more emotive Bill Hader. Good. Lauren, if you said you're like a mom, you're the cool mom. Thank you. I can still talk. Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high.
We're going to have to cut that because of legal reasons.
My compliment was you complimenting J.K.
Rowling. I like that my 15 seconds are just going to be Lauren laughing. All right? And my 15 seconds are up. Lauren?
I'm not ready.
All right, that's her 15 seconds.
My 15 seconds is apologizing to anyone who has to hear my sharpened laugh.
All right, let's do plugs.
Let's do plugs. Plug bag.
We can plagiarize, but not that much.
I'm sorry with Elijah.
Like to plug A Bit of Fry and Laurie, which is a British sketch comedy show that was on in the 90s, because it has Hugh Laurie, who played House, and Stephen Fry, who's a hero of mine.
Mm-hmm. Oh, very interesting. RG, any plugs?
I have to plug OUTV, which is a high-end television. It's film club I'm in. Also, Lauren and James are in it, so it's pretty cool. Also, I want to plug whatever YouTube channel I eventually start.
Yeah. Eventually.
It's out there.
We'll get there. We'll put it in post in, like, a year. All right, let's see. What is my plug going to be this week? The decrease in bear attacks over the last few years. I'm really proud of bears not attacking us.
It's very cool.
You know they're, like, prominent in Northeast Ohio?
Good job, bears.
Like, at least once a year, there's a bear running around Youngstown.
Neat.
Yeah.
So, hey, bears, you cool. You cool in my book.
You cool.
Hanging out in Ohio, not attacking people. Well, attacking people less. You cool.
I'm going to plug white chocolate lattes. Because nice. They are great. And I feel like they're underrated compared to, like, Pumpkin Spice.
You also probably have a legitimate plug.
I don't.
Yeah, you do.
What?
The Sundial.
Well, that's a given.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to plug the Sundial.
Don't read the Sundial.
What? I'd like to plug McDonald's. They have the best hamburgers.
Who's that old man that just walked into the studio? What is your name?
My name is Tobias Ellen.
Ellen?
Gregory.
How did you get here? It is like the union closes in like an hour.
I am from the future, and we do not have McDonald's.
Oh, so you went back in time to go to a McDonald's.
Enjoy the McDonald's where it lives.
And he came here to plug it on this podcast.
Because he knew the world-famous Elijah was going to be on the podcast, yeah. And there were going to be
so
many.
I love your cooking show. Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's very popular.
You guys have very similar voices. Are you sure you guys aren't related? Oh my gosh, that old man just exploded. There are chunks of him everywhere in the studio.
It was a very, very silent explosion.
I am
coated in old man.
If I may say
Archie just saying delicious. What his future old man tastes like.
McDonald's.
Alright, that's the podcast.
That's the plugs. If you want to ask a question or have a topic suggestion, email us at thesundialmagazine@gmail.com. Check out our website, sundial.osu.edu. Tweet us your... Wait, we never even answered the 10 out of 10 butt because Elijah ruined it.
Answer your 10 out of 10 butt or just say Elijah ruined it.
Yeah.
Tweet at us, Elijah ruined it.
At the Sundial OSU.
They're a 10 out of 10, but they ruin hypothetical games.
There we go. That's the one.
That's the one we're going to
go 10 out of 10,
with.
But they ruin hypothetical games. So tweet at Sundial.
At the Sundial OSU.
Yes or no.
On Twitter. Yes or no to that question. Or how... I was going to say, how Elijah made you feel about it.
Yeah. And Roger, we haven't forgot about you.
Roger.
We'll hit you up soon.
Yeah.
Alright.
Thanks for listening, everyone.
Goodbye.
Bye.
That was a train wreck. That was like scripted as fuck, Lauren.